I want to read a passage of scripture this morning. This is from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. The man of God, I would insist, the woman of God, the people of God, may be adequate and equipped for every good work. Profitable for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Let's go to the Lord today as we begin our time of worship together. Lord, we live in a world of illusion where science, secular knowledge, and rules and regulations are a part of our lives, trying to get us to buy in to the truth that really is not the truth. We live in a world that wants its ears tickled with what sounds good and what's popular with one group or another group. Lord, your word is truth. God breathed, and it instructs us. Sometimes it disciplines us. Sometimes it becomes an insulator to protect us. But always, it is there if we will follow it to profit us in every facet of our lives, our academic lives, our professional lives, our relationships, even our personal health and well-being. So today, as we worship, grant us truth. Grant us understanding as we worship you. For you are the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us with power and glory and hope and salvation. Amen. You know, Jesus reminded us that the harvest is plentiful, the workers are few. We're getting ready to come into a very busy week. Next week, we have Trunk or Treat, where we're going to be able to give out not only the candy, but the love in the form of a scarf, gloves to kids so that they can be warm waiting for the bus. And then we have the Men's Brotherhood the next night. Talked to Dave this week. We kind of emailed each other back and forth, and he's ready for the men's meeting. And then that next weekend is REC. The next two weekends, actually. So we're going to have some men REC and some women REC. Frontline stuff. That doesn't mean that we're, the rest of us can relax and take it easy. because our prayers are needed for all this. Amen. Our encouragement is needed for all this. Next week we will be commissioning those that are a part of the REC for this fall, and we hope that you'll be here for that. But let's begin now praying. God's word is powerful. It can reach beyond prison's doors. It can set captives free. Free from drugs, free from sin, free from addictions, free from their own anguish and relationships that have been severed. Let's begin now praying for those that will go and for those that are there. Let's have some good old-fashioned jailbreaks. Lawful, of course. Let's go to the Lord in prayer right now. Lord, we live in a world that is broken. A world that has bought the lie that says I'm a loser. I can't get the education that I needed. I can't get the job that I want. I don't have the provisions to support myself. Lord, we're not talking about other folks. We're talking about our families, where alcohol and drugs and addiction and incarceration are facts of the past. And we struggle with how to love and how to forgive, how to be kind, and how to show the way without feeling or being proud or seeming to be hypocritical. Lord, today we come just as we are. And without the blood, without the cross that might be us on the inside. Now we get a chance to help some people break some chains, to break with their past and to develop relationships with churches and believers that can guide them and help them and support them and pray for them so that the old habits of the past can give way to a new path of life. We pray for these things in your precious name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing the song before Pastor's message. The Lord's laid on his heart. Break now the bread of life. Praise the Lord. You may be seated.
We're in this series called Footsteps of Jesus, which basically is the story of Acts and the missionary journeys of Paul the Apostle. We're in the 10th message of this, and we're really beginning today the third missionary journey. I'm going to be reading in verses chapter 18. We're going to begin at verse 23. And be going through chapter 19 through verse 10. And having spent some time there, he left and passed successively through the Galatian region and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Now a Jew named Apollos, an Alexandrian by birth, an eloquent man, came to Ephesus, and he was mighty in the scriptures. This man had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he was speaking and teaching accurately the things concerning Jesus, being acquainted only with the baptism of John. And he began to speak out boldly in this synagogue. But when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. And when he wanted to go across to Achaia, the brethren encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. When he had arrived, he greatly helped those who had believed through grace, for he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, demonstrating by the scriptures that Jesus was the Christ. It happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus and found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said to him, "No, we've not even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with a baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was coming after him, that is, in Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking with tongues and prophesying. There were about 12 men. And he entered the synagogue and continued speaking boldly for 3 months, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. But when some who were becoming hardened and disobedient, speaking evil of the way before the people, he withdrew from them and took away the disciples, reasoning daily in the school of Tyrannus. This took place for 2 years, so that all who lived in Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading from God's word. Can you all hear me well?
Yep.
All right. When it comes to the gospel, we're talking about the ability to do something excellent. Now, an athlete, if he wants to be a good athlete, will have training. There's training year-round, conditioning. Conditioning the body, the mind, the emotions. And then there's practices every day prior to and even in the season. The idea is to fill in the gaps of skills
so that they are adequate to do the job. The same as learning how to do scales, chords, and all the things that are connected with blowing a horn or striking a string or playing the notes, beating a pattern that people can follow. So it is even in our professions. You don't want a guy getting ready to do an appendectomy on you that never went to medical school. You want somebody that didn't just do a YouTube on how to do that. It seems like of John Wesley. As the Great Awakening started in the New England states and went west, John Wesley was among the great preachers of his time. He said, 100 men who love nothing but God and who hate nothing but evil change the world. Now, he was a pretty good organizer. The only problem is he didn't have a lot to work with. A lot of men who felt the call of God to preach. And he would organize circuit riders. And they would go out with a Bible and a hymnal with some helps on how to marry and bury and preach, and they would have a circuit. And they'd go around to the same churches over and over and over again. You didn't get to have church every week because there was a circuit. It was into that denomination that I got to know some things as a student in a Methodist school, my first years in college. A guy by the name of Phil. Phil was not like most of the students. I wasn't either, for that matter. By the time I got to know him, we were both married. He'd been in the military for about 10 years. He had actually qualified as a medic, and they had trained him to be an X-ray technician. Very fine license. But when he got out after 10 years, he decided there was something else he wanted to do with his life. So he took the X-ray training and he would sub in and do the on-call kind of thing at the hospital. Earn a little bit of money that way. His wife got a job. And he enrolled in school and took his GI Bill and began to go through all the academics. He was very good in math. Troubles in math, and came to him and he explained things that the professor, you know, they didn't know how to do. But he had this call. A call to preach. And he had all this experience as far as life was concerned. I mean, military, medical, with X-ray expertise. So he went to the pastor, who went to the district superintendent, and they said, we will give you a license to preach. You just got to add another 3 hours to your academics every week and learn some things about the Methodist Church and how we do things and the polity of how things work. We don't want to put somebody into a church that don't know what they're doing. At least some things. Now understand, only 6 months after he had felt the call to preach, and he began to preach, he was preaching, he would invite some of the students his church. Sunday, cafeteria was closed all day long. They had, you know, there was a boy in one of the classes from India. Brilliant young man. He could scan a page and tell you everything on the page as fast as he could turn it. He read more books, I swear to goodness, in a night than he ever read any thing that was in church. In time, he felt the tug of the Holy Spirit about he was from India, where in some places in India his family might prevent doing that with Christianity. He didn't have any of that. A profession of faith and to join the church. The night before he was going to do all this and begin this process, got a call from a leader in the church, and they had they become members and then they would graduate. And they were you. I'm popping and jumping around all over. I better stay still, I guess. So anyway, got this call. Half the people are getting ready to leave the church because they don't want to belong to the church with a black student. What do you do with that? Was ready. But I and the intentions to the minds of Jews was a conscience. Things and the Spirit. Hold of us. It's dark. From hatred. Route. Distance in form of external things, but also internal things. And we've looked at revelation. Moments of insight where we see in Scripture breakthrough. Something supernatural that happened. So we're going to continue that. So what we have... Next slide. The route... This... The map. I didn't get all of the map, but I think I got enough of it that you can follow it. Paul begins his mission, this is his third tour in Syria. That's the starting point, clear over on the right. A crossover around through Cilicia, Tarsus, right past where he was born and raised. He's going to enter Galatia, Derbe and Iconium, Lystra. Those were some places where he had some earlier miracles in his first missionary journey. It's also where he was stoned once. But he is delivering letters of encouragement from the church. And he is strengthening those leaders. His mission is all about evangelism, planting new churches, bringing the good news of Jesus Christ. It's all about edification, the leaders and the churches during the time of mission and economic relief. He is bringing up offerings to take back. Tracks through Galatia. And then he cuts over and he takes the interior to Asia Minor, to a place called Ephesus. Now, earlier in his previous journey, it wasn't time. The Holy Spirit says, don't go to Asia yet. Don't go to Phrygia. So, going to Macedonia. This time, it's... And he ends up in Ephesus. Now, Ephesus is a... sports. It had a lot of entertainment, but also pagan worship. The Greek god Artemis was there. A great big temple that Paul stays for 3 years. Time that he stays in any place is planted. Metropolis city. But it's in this city that I want us to realize the resistance. The resistance that I'm talking about today has to do with how we resist by harsh edits. The difference between the Judaizers who wanted to bend the church to be Jewish and to preach a gospel where you had to be circumcised to be a Christian. That to be the church. There's a difference between that who only have a piece of the story. This place, Ephesus, there's a man by the name of Apollos. Apollos, I would describe him as a very zealous and eloquent teacher, but he wasn't saved yet. Now hang on with this. It says that he had a thorough understanding, which means he knew his Old Testament very well. He knew Abraham, he knew Egypt, he knew the Exodus, he knew history. He knew the story of King David and all that. Prophetic books. Moriah. He even knew about Jesus. But he was acquainted with only the baptism of John the Baptist. Which means he knew the story of Jesus as far as his life, love, his he did or was the prelude. which was the preaching of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was a forerunner. He was the watchman that would come and call. Have all the information. A Christian. On the who were some of Paul's traveling companions, they got to know Paul in Corinth. They were 10 men. He stayed with them, and they were, because they were the same trade, they met a lot of things. But this time, they're in Ephesus, and they don't scold him. They don't embarrass him. Probably they invited him to dinner. And they said, you know this Jesus that you so carefully have talked about, his birth, his life. Did you know that he died on the cross? That his death was a sacrifice for our sins? But he didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead 3 days later. And he ascended into heaven. He intercedes for us now. And he sent his Holy Spirit. Has come now. So he got what he needed. He got salvation. He got the full story. See why it's important for us. It isn't just about the life of Jesus. There was a man many years ago, he tried to rediscover the life of the historical Jesus. Meaning he wanted to focus only on his teachings and what he did. Not his death, burial, resurrection, ascension, promise of the Holy Spirit. Now, that's Aquila and Priscilla had dealt with Apollos. Paul arrives, also in Ephesus, a different part of the city, and he encounters 12 apostles that Apollos has named. They're students of his. They have the same shortcomings that Apollos had had. What I want this morning is this revelation. From an empowering touch of Paul on these 12 disciples. Go to the next slide. As we look at our text today, what we read earlier in Acts 19, let's come back to it. What we find as Paul encounters these people in verse 2. It says, he said to these, they were talking about these 12 apostles or disciples. He said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And we're talking about the Holy Spirit that Jesus promised. That is the paraclete. The Holy Spirit that comes alive inside of us when we believe. When we make our decision to follow Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord, when we're baptized in obedience into His command, receive the Spirit right then. There is not a second blessing. Churches do teach that there's a second blessing you need to pursue, the fullness of the Spirit. No, we have the Spirit right then. We just need to welcome it into our lives in every facet. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they said to him, we have not even heard whether there is a Spirit. The discovery is there was something lacking. And in verse 3 we find out, and he said, he quizzes them, into what then were you baptized? And they said, into John's baptism. John was a forerunner. He was washing people for their sins, getting them ready for the promise of Jesus. Right? So there was a detail they didn't have. Look at verse 4. Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was coming after him, that is in Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Think of that. They're already in missions. Just not saved yet. They didn't have all the information. In verse 6 it says, when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them and they began speaking in tongues and prophesying. There were in all about 12 men. When Jesus touches them, the Holy Spirit comes alive. Now I want us to understand the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You believe, confess, I've got the Holy Spirit, and somebody touches you. It's the Spirit that touches us. This is the last time in Acts needing to be touched for the fullness of the Holy Spirit to come. You believe, you confess, I'm a Christian, and it's there. The Holy Spirit. That's what knocks off our tempers. Cowardly, and we're afraid to say something. That's what Jesus is. And in REC and everything else, there we confess Him, believe in Him. He's there then. Paul is going to get run out of town after a while. He always does. Every time he preaches, there's a riot and they run him off. The Jews run him off. But there is a core that is educated in the Scriptures. They know the story about Jesus' crucifixion, His resurrection, His promise. It's available now. It's the whole story. It's what we need for salvation. Yes. There are some things in our life we have to throw out. You know? You ever go through your drawers, the junk drawer in your kitchen, the storage closet in your basement, or your attic, or your garage, or your storage building? There are some things in there that are not relevant anymore. Clothes that don't fit anymore. The styles that you wore when you were a teenager. You know you would never be caught dead in today. You hope your grandkids don't ever see you with that suit on. You know what I'm talking about. There are some things for us to throw out. Look at Luke 3:16. It's on your screen. As for me, I baptize you with water. This is John the Baptist. But one is coming who is mightier than I. Baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. We're beyond that. We're beyond that. We're beyond that to the day the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost, and this is what we have and in each other. On that day, those 3,000 people who heard Peter preach, when they heard him preach, the crowd says, what shall we do? And Jesus said, repent. To repent means to turn around. To think differently about your life, about sin, about what's going on there. Repent, turn around, let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And 3,000 people said, yes. Sign me up. Why this is... We all need to know of salvation. Now Jesus sins according to the Spirit. From the dead, according to the Spirit. And to the 12, to people like the Apostle and Jesus, that has appeared to you and me, saying, come. But he has not left us as orphans. As in 6, as orphans. And the Holy Spirit. Her. With you. That is there is no conversion. He talks to us and encourages us every day. Of his Spirit, that's sanctification. Jesus. And will continue to do so until our day of glory. Lie that says you got to get another experience. Welcome the Spirit. Welcome Him into every part of your life. Alone. About quit smoking and I'm going to do it by my own willpower. I'm going to go on a diet by my own willpower. No. You don't have to do it that way. Let's pray. Oh Lord, you have given us salvation. And you have granted us, when we are saved, the blessing of your Spirit. All we have to do is begin to listen to that still, small voice, that intuition that leads us and guides us and helps us in our reading of Scripture and in our practice of faith to be your witnesses to the ends of the earth. Be with us when we encounter those who haven't got it all together and their understanding. Help us to be patient. Help us to be tactful. To be able to explain to them what we know, what we've heard from your word. Also be with us as we do battle with those who have taken and who have, well, they're wolves in sheep's clothing. They're really not Christians. They're not in for salvation or for any kind of heavenly thing. They're in it for themselves. Help us to deal with those too. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't know what decision in your life today,
but let's welcome the Spirit. Let's welcome the Spirit that is in our lives if we've been saved. Let's walk in that way. Let's walk in that way and see how the Lord will work in our lives. Let's sing together our song of decision. Prayer that I pray every day as I have my time with the Lord and with His Word. Open my eyes and let me see glimpses of truth that You have for me. Lord, thank You for Your Word, that You are the Word, that You spoke the Word into being, and that a part of Your Word is in our hearts through Your Holy Spirit. Now go with us as we leave this place. You might say this is our practice, and we enter the mission field of our world. And we go from what we have heard on this Sunday morning to our Monday morning. In Jesus' name, amen.